In this section, we discuss some of the most important thin film processing techniques used for thin film solar cells. In the preceding videos, we discussed plasma-enhanced chemical vapor deposition, which is primarily used for the deposition of thin film silicon alloys. In this video and the next, we will discuss 8 more deposition techniques that are of special importance for the thin film technology discussed in this course. These deposition techniques are sputtering deposition and evaporation deposition, which are mostly used for TCOs and metallic layers. Closed-space sublimation and chemical bath deposition are mostly used for chalcocyanides and cadmium telluride technology. We will discuss molecular beam epitaxy and metal organic chemical vapor deposition, which are epitaxial deposition techniques used for the 3-5 technologies. We will then discuss atomic layer deposition, which is primarily used for supporting layers such as TCOs and passivation layers. And finally, spin coating is used for organic photovoltaics. Creating a basic understanding of the working principles of these techniques is the learning objective of this video. We start with the sputtering deposition. This is physical vapor deposition technique, which means that it is a vacuum deposition technology that produces the source gas by a non-chemical method. Much like PECVD, sputtering takes place in a vacuum chamber between a grounded electrode and a powered electrode. A substrate is placed at the grounded electrode or anode. The target material, so the material we want to evaporate and sputter onto the substrate, is part of the powered electrode or cathode. The process starts by introducing a gas in the vacuum chamber. Argon is generally used because it's inert, susceptible to ionization, and the atoms are relatively heavy. A plasma is then ignited using either a DC or an AC bias, depending on the target material. For a metallic target, often a DC bias is used. For insulating targets and dielectrics, an AC bias is required, as we explained in the preceding video. Through collisions in the plasma, the argon ions gain energy and momentum. The positively charged argon ions hit the target surface, which has a negative bias with respect to the plasma, releasing atoms from the target material. Upon impact, the heavy argon ions cause the target atom to shift to the gas phase, so evaporate. In its gaseous form, the target atoms diffuse towards the substrate, where a thin film of the target material will grow. In addition, other gases like nitrogen or oxygen can be mixed with the argon in order to produce nitritic or oxidic coatings. This picture shows the vacuum chamber of a sputtering tool. This particular device has 3 separate targets. We can't actually see the targets themselves because they are closed with a shutter. With this tool, we can select which target we want to use to deposit a film on our substrate. For co-sputtering, we can use multiple targets at once to create a mixed material on a substrate, located on the bottom. Co-sputtering is one of the techniques used for CIGS production. Sputtering is already a widely used technique performed on an industrial level. Sputtering is often used to deposit transparent conductive oxide (TCO) layers, such as indium tin oxide or aluminum doped zinc oxide. While for the former, a target consisting of 10% tin dioxide and 90% di-indium trioxide is used, for the latter, the target consists of a zinc oxide and 2% aluminum. Sputtering can also be used for depositing metallic layers. In our research group, we generally use evaporation deposition for that purpose, however. Evaporation sputtering is a physical vapor deposition technique that takes place in a vacuum chamber. The target material is placed in a boat in the vacuum chamber. The substrate is placed above the target material. Deposition of a metallic layer with evaporation is realized by heating the metallic source material above its melting point, which subsequently condensates on the cooler surface of the substrate, leading to the formation of a thin film. There are two ways to accomplish the evaporation of the target material. The most straightforward is the resistive heating of the target, which is used, for instance, to evaporate silver. The target is used as a resistor and a large current is conducted through the target. The current dissipates energy in the boat, causing the target to heat up and evaporate. It is therefore important that the chamber is kept at very low pressure because in vacuum conditions the target evaporates at much lower temperatures. Secondly, the electron beam evaporation can be applied. This type of evaporation is used for, amongst other, chromium and aluminium depositions. For electron beam evaporation, the metallic source is loaded in a water-cooled crucible. The target material is then irradiated by an intense electron beam. The electron beam is generated through resistive heating of a tungsten filament and is directed by strong magnetic fields. Again, the vacuum conditions are important here to avoid the reaction of the target material with any particles like oxygen or water. The vacuum is also important to avoid the disruption of the electron beam, which could lead to inhomogeneities in the deposited material. This picture shows the inside of the evaporation tool available to our research group here at the Delft University. Four substrates can simultaneously be mounted on this rotating holder. The substrates rotate during the deposition to improve the homogeneity of the film. On the right is the boat for the resistive heating where the silver is evaporated. The targets for electron beam evaporation are on the left. Multiple crucibles are located here containing targets like chromium and aluminium. The magnetic section guides the electron beam while, depending on the evaporation method used, these shuttles will close off the boats to prevent contamination. Another evaporation technique often used for the deposition of cadmium telluride is closed space sublimation. We will discuss closed space sublimation in the next video, where we'll continue our discussion of the important thin film processing techniques.